Everyone, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogeo Power Sports and Yamaha. I'm joined by my longtime buddy, Will Hahn, who is now team trainer for the Troy Lee Designs RedBull GASGAS Factory Racing team. So it's so weird. It's like the only person that's ever changed teams mid-season that I remember was James Stewart. So you and James Stewart are like in good company.
I mean, if I can be in company with James at any point in my career or life, then I'm pretty happy, I guess.
Okay, so tell me about your new role and how did this come about and why the mid-season thing?
The timing of it wasn't good. I mean, obviously I had to tell the guys in Supercross that I wasn't going to make the travel or the move to Florida. Mm-hmm. Obviously decided to stay here, got family here, and we obviously want to have kids soon, so... her mom and dad are nearby to us. Her dad's my neighbor, so it all kind of makes sense as far as that goes. And obviously, I did want to stay here. I mean, we got everything that I want. We got beach and mountains and all kinds of stuff within an hour, so it's pretty nice. And I think just the timing was right. Obviously, Seth came in and learned pretty quick, and it was time for me to kind of, start on my new chapter here. Mm-hmm. Even though it's tough, and obviously midseason is never a good look, and it's not something I wanted to do, and I didn't want to be negative towards the starter guys at all, because obviously, the last 5 years of my life, they treated me really, really good and gave me an opportunity post-racing that I think is very hard to come by, mm-hmm. and didn't want to take that for granted either. It's just the transition, and then how this came about, obviously Justin and I have been friends for a long time, and he wanted me to come be on in his corner, and then... honestly, Tyler's tried to, he's wanted to hire me every year since I've been done racing as well. And depending on the role and the timing and everything like that, this was the right thing to do. And I'm lucky it turned into being a team thing and extremely grateful for it.
Yeah. Okay, so the star team, Bisery Carmichael's Ranch, decides to move to Florida. Like, how long ago was that decision made? And was the decision made just boom by like, Bobby, or was it everyone decided it?
I think from the team standpoint and everything like that, to build it into having an infrastructure like that and own the building. I mean, obviously everyone knows out here that if you can get a rental, it's really expensive. And like I said, because there's no, everything's vacant. Everyone's got their leases tied up and long-term people are there and they're not going to leave because probably the price is right, et cetera. I can't remember the time frame when this all started happening. Sometime last season, I'm imagining, if I remember right. But, I mean, from the team standpoint, it's 100% makes sense.
Mm-hmm. On the East Coast, where like everyone seems to think, being on the East is better for training and travel and all that. Do you agree? Because like you were a racer at that point. Did you go back East?
I did. I did a few times. Like obviously when, my parents and my brother lived in Texas, I would go back there for the summer. For the heat, and then the tracks are a little bit better and stuff like that. I've gone to Florida. I've stayed in Louisiana/Mississippi at Kevin's on the East Coast swings. It's got its ups and downs. It's like anything, right? Like here, there's a lot of good and there's some bad, and over there, there's a lot of good and there's some bad too. Sometimes it's really hard to escape the humidity too, mm-hmm. not be sweating all day long. So part of that's going to be a little bit tough, I'm sure, but at the same time, like I said, these guys, I mean, look at their resume, so I'm sure they're going to figure it out quickly.
Yeah. Okay, so your move or your stay was motivated by your fiance, mostly, you think? Or like, because you're going to get married, you're going to start a family, all that?
I would say, yeah, that was part of it, but it wasn't the deciding factor. I mean, we sat down on the couch and made this decision, collectively.
Yeah.
And we just looked at each other and like we both really honestly in our hearts wanted to stay here. Like,
yeah,
I'm not from here. She is, but I've built a life here, like it or not, regardless of how I feel about anything here. I do have a life here. I have mm-hmm. a rental house here in Menifee. So it's like I still have a lot of stuff here that I've built myself into, and obviously a lot of friends too. So
yeah,
to start over at this point, to me didn't. I couldn't make sense of it.
Mm. Okay, so you were. At Star, you were post-racing, you're assistant team manager for several years, and then you stepped into the team manager role. How much did your job change when you became the team manager? Or had you been doing all the same stuff anyway?
I wouldn't say it really changed dramatically. I think it was more so like Brad had honestly taught me enough by then to understand how to handle it and not have to ask 15 questions on everything, you know, yeah. as I, you know, he was basically, was under his wing for multiple years, and he showed me like how to handle situations and how to understand it, and didn't really change dramatically, no. Mm-hmm.
So, the travel, you know, I mean, you traveled for years as a racer, right? Traveling as a team manager, was it more stressful, the same, or less?
Probably more, I mean, than racing for sure. I mean, I didn't really do that many full seasons, to be honest with you. So, my only full season as a professional was my first season in 2008. So, other than that, until I retired, wasn't doing full seasons very often. So, mm-hmm. To me, I still enjoy it. I mean, do I like being gone from the dog and, you know, my fiance? No, mm-hmm. not really. But I still enjoy it. I enjoy seeing the new cities, trying to find a new restaurant that's not a chain, different coffees and stuff like that. I still enjoy it for sure. I mean, granted, there's some times during the year where you're like, man, I just want to be home for a weekend. But mm-hmm. that's with anything.
Yeah. Okay, so tell me about the fiance, dude. It's like, she's your neighbor's daughter?
Yes.
So, you know, you're mowing the lawn. I'm like, oh, hey, hi.
No. So she lives with, she lived at the time with her mom. But I think it was Christmas Eve, Christmas night after Christmas, something like that. I can't remember the exact day, which probably should. Her dad invited me over, like, hey, come have a beer. It's Christmas or Christmas time or however it was worded. And I'm like, nah, you know, it's all good. We're good. And he said, no, I'll get over here. So we went over there and we're hanging out by the fire. And I had never met her and introduced us and thought she was really cute, funny and everything like that. So I was like, well, try to shoot my shot here and throw it out there. And ended up somehow working and then asking for his permission because, I mean, we were hanging out quite a bit on the weekends and stuff. He'd be in the garage and... Mm-hmm. Yeah, her dad rides and everything like that. So I got to know him really well first. So it was more like out of respect for him. I wanted to make sure he was okay with it. And yeah, he was. And next thing you know, yeah, now we're getting married at the end of the year.
So it was like an old fashioned meet somebody in person. It was no DMs, no apps, no swiping right or left.
Yeah, it was one of those deals where you're like, you know, everyone always told me like when you least expect it, it's when it's going to happen. And it totally happened like that.
Yeah, because you've been walking around grocery stores for years, right?
Yeah, like please, like maybe give me CPR or something. Like, I don't know. But yeah, it worked out so organically that it was pretty crazy.
Yeah. Okay, so then, you know, you told me when you're going to propose, right? And I'm like, dude, let me know. I'll come hide in the bushes with my big camera and everything. And you just got too anxious, right?
I was so nervous, dude. And like, what ring? What ring do you? Well, you can't ask her what she likes because then it gives it away. I wanted to really surprise her. I didn't want her to know what I was doing. And you know, then I ask opinions, but then you got 18 opinions, and they're all different. And then you're more confused. And it was just like, all right, I'm gonna get what I want. And because I kept trying to tell myself, like, dude, whatever you get, it's a gift. Like, yeah. She's going to love it no matter what because it's from you.
Yeah.
So eventually I just was like, all right, get what you want. Got it. And then the night, you know, I was doing it, my mom was out here. And my mom and her mom, we went to dinner together to, you know, I wanted my mom and her mom to meet. We were having this nice dinner. And I had the ring in my pocket. And she never touches my leg at dinner. And the whole time I'm like, she's like touching my leg. And I'm swatting, like, stop, what are you doing? Like, stop. Because I was like, surely if I put it in the pocket, she never puts her hand there, it's totally safe. And I was like, the whole time, I'm like, dude, like, go stop, please stop. But yeah, luckily got it handled. And yeah, I was nervous. I think I put it on the wrong finger, if I remember right. I mean, I don't know, I'm not that good
at that. Well, you sent me the picture. It's like somebody's iPhone picture or something, right?
Yeah, my mom.
Dude, I was at your disposal.
But I was like, one of those things where I was like, let's just do it.
Were you nervous that she was going to say no? Or did you know?
I wasn't until Wyndham told me that he was there for me when she says no. And then I even thought about it. And I was like, oh, shit, Amy, what if she does say no?
Oh, yeah. I just can't believe Wil Hahn's getting married.
I know, it's shocking to everybody.
You know, and that I thought it was a hoax, right? Like, you know, I don't know. And then I met her at one of my Swapmoto Race Series events. And I'm like, oh, wow. You like the picture I sent you?
No. No.
Nice. Okay, so the wedding, I'm sure, is coming up.
Yep.
Soon. It's like a weekday, right?
Yeah, it's on a Monday.
Yeah.
You're welcome for time off for everybody that's coming. Yeah, like, everyone's bitching about Monday, but it's like, dude, you get out of work. It's okay.
Yeah, it's funny because I was like, always like, man, if I ever got married again, I'd get married on a weekday so I don't ruin anyone's weekend. Right?
Well, with everything that's going on in the world right now, it's finding a venue and then also getting a venue date is like pretty impossible.
Yeah. Dude, that save the date picture, you look really young when you clean up.
Yeah, dude, if I shave, it's like straight back to junior high. Like it's, I don't know, I was all excited. I think it was RedBud. I went and got a straight razor in Old Town Temecula, and I got out of the truck and a haircut. Can't do both at once. I remember that now. I'll write that down. Keep that in the logbook, because if you do both at once, short hair and a fresh shave like that, it's a
different person.
It's literally like being 12 all over again. Nice. Except for I just have my braces now, which that's a plus.
Yeah, the braces are off.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Cool.
Never again.
All right, well, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for more with Wil Hahn. Hey guys, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGO Power Sports and Yamaha. Here with Wil Hahn, who's about to tie the knot. Okay, so you're going to get married. You have this new role as team trainer. What does the team training involve? Are you responsible right now for Justin Barcia, Pierce Brown, and Michael Mosman?
Yes.
And that's just on the bike? Because obviously you have a lot of riding knowledge to share.
Yeah.
But it's on the bike and off the bike,
correct.
Nutrition, everything?
Yeah, kind of a little bit of everything. And like I said, I'm learning as I go too, and I think these guys they understand that, including the riders, that I've never, I mean, I trained my whole career, obviously, mm-hmm. But never trained anybody myself. So it's exciting, it's a challenge for sure, and I'm learning as I go, but I kind of know the do's and don'ts from when I was racing, but also it's like there's evolution, right? So like for me, the biggest thing that I'm trying to do is to not be closed-minded. As things change, you got to adapt to situations, or they're testing, or they're riding. There's just certain days that you want to switch the program, and there's times for that, but there's also times to have some wiggle room here and there. And then obviously trying to get my gym all set up and stuff like that, and go from there.
So is it the Wil Hahn Powerhouse gym in your garage?
Yep.
So they're coming to your house to work out?
Yep.
So is the garage just strictly a gym, or do you park cars in there, bikes?
No, I won't have anything in there. I still have a couple bikes right now. Cars, no, both my truck doesn't fit, and Taylor's vehicle doesn't fit either. So for me, it's going to be more so like make it legit.
So is there a benefit to doing it at your house rather than going to, say, the W or something?
For me, I like the fact that I can clean it. I can kind of keep my eye on everything, and not so much coronavirus stuff like that. But it's just as the year progresses and stuff like that, or boot camp where everyone's tired and it's kind of the winter months of like sicknesses going around. I think the more we can isolate ourselves away, not have to wait on machines. There's kind of everything, and like we don't need everything that's at a gym. We need the specific items and go from there. I think we'd be productive easier like that in that setting, mm-hmm. except for days like today where it's
really,
you know, it's
hot.
Pretty toasty.
You have
so.
An air conditioner in there?
No.
No, so it's sweat.
It's a sweatshop, yeah.
So do the three guys come at the same time?
Yeah, that'll change. I mean, right now when we're in the, like I said, in this four-race swing, and then we take a couple week break, and then we do five in a row. Yeah, we can get away with that. But I think come off season and stuff like that, it'll be more some like one-on-one and keeping an eye on it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is it any coincidence that you are team trainer for, you know, a few weeks? Moseman gets his first podium. Barsha gets his first win.
I mean, I would love to take the credit there, but no, it just comes from, I think, obviously they're believing in everything they're doing right now, but the team's working their ass off right now to get them comfy as well. We're all just, I think it's more so the whole team coming together and we're all going for the same goal.
Mm-hmm.
The guys are riding really well right now. I mean, I'd love to say it's me, but I didn't twist the throttle.
Yeah.
Like these guys are still doing all the work, so... I think it's just a collaboration of all of us together pushing them in the right direction.
Mm-hmm. As team trainer, are you doing anything on the bike? Have you ridden a GASGAS yet?
No.
Okay, so you won't be enlisted to help test or...
No, and just to be honest, like I don't really have that ambition anymore. Like I don't really want to ride that
you
much.
You had to do that a lot at Star, right?
Yeah, and that was and I loved it.
Testing for all 14 guys.
Yeah. No, and I loved it. Like, and I still was riding a lot then. But now that I've kind of taken a break. Now that even though my last couple months there, I didn't really ride very much.
Mm-hmm.
And now that I've kind of backed away from it, I'm honestly enjoying it. Not having to go ride. Like, trust me, I still love riding. I want to go ride, but like, me go ride on my own.
Yeah.
Nothing to worry about. Not having to think too much. Like, just go ride naturally. I still would love to go do that. Love to get a bike and go do that for fun. But no, as far as testing, like you got to be so sharp, and you got to be pretty. You still got to go fast.
Mm-hmm.
Like right now, I want to go ride. I don't want to worry about, am I hitting the bumps fast enough, or can I even feel it? You know, or feel the change or anything like that. Like anymore. Like if I want to go ride, I want to go ride and have some fun.
Yeah. Okay. So on that note, GASGAS, 250, 450. They have a 350 now. A 125 and a 252 stroke. What do you choose to ride for fun?
I think I get a 125.
Really?
Yeah, I think I really enjoy riding them because you can ride, like I can, you know, at least go ride super hard and not be dangerous in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
Like for me, if I go get on a 450 now and I want to ride hard, they're too damn fast. Like if you don't ride enough, you know, if you're sharp and everything's good like that, yeah, of course I'd rather ride a 450. It's faster, the jumps are easy, everything like that's nice, but. For me, I want to at least sound like I'm going fast, but if I'm only going 20 down a straightaway, that's fine with me.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, dude, we filmed the premix video, and was that, what track was that in Texas?
Oak Hill,
on the CR125.
Yeah.
That was so awesome because you sounded like you were 200% effort, right?
Yeah, and I feel like I was going, it sounded like you're going 100 miles an hour, but you're literally going 10 through a corner.
Yeah. But still, you rode that thing really well.
I was sharp then, though.
Yeah, sharp then. But, okay, so talk about the guys. Like, Justin, you were teammates with him on Geico then, right?
Yeah, I think three or 4 years.
Okay, so is that where the relationship was
started? Yeah, I mean, obviously, he was young. I mean, I was the old guy on the team. I think I was 21. But he was a young guy coming in. So much energy. Obviously, not a lot of filter. Everyone knows that with mm-hmm. him. And the entertainment value. But his determination and like, how motivated he is, like you don't have to doubt that kid is giving everything he has. It doesn't matter what he's doing. If it's the bicycle, the gym, the dirt bike, I mean, anything with you, it doesn't matter what you're doing. It's a, you know, he wants to win.
Yeah.
And so we always got along through our career. Like, yeah, I mean, I'm sure he's taken me out a few times, but I think he's done that to everybody. And that's what I love about him. Like he doesn't hide from it. It's been a breath of fresh air, honestly.
Yeah. Okay. So Justin's like one of those guys that's like, super fit, I would think, right? He's so into cycling.
Yep.
And all that. I mean, is there much to teach him fitness wise or?
No, I think for him, I mean, he's done it and tried it all. I think mm-hmm. he's at that point in his career. I think more right now is just assuring him that this is the right stuff. It's okay to do less today.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's okay. We got four races in a row. Like this is enough. or like him and I talking, like, you know, he might tell me like, hey, that might be a little too much. And like I said, I'm here to listen. Like, he knows his body better than I do. So, yeah, learning that, obviously, it's exciting. And then also, like I said, you don't have to worry about him. I think he's turned over every stone he can as far as that goes.
Yeah. Okay. Michael Mosman. I mean, he's super funny guy, right?
Totally.
The facts of the day and everything. But.
Oh, yeah. He's got a response for everything. He's entertained. This is actually like the first week we've been together. He's been in Florida and stuff like that. But being out here, still getting to know him. Great personality. I mean, he's got, like you said, a lot of facts. He's very smart, a very intelligent kid, reads a lot of books. I love all that about him. And he rides so effortlessly, but yet, if you were watching it, you'd be like, you know, not that impressed, but you get it on a stopwatch and it's like, wow, man, this kid's, he's legit. Mm-hmm.
What about him? Is there much to teach him, get his fitness better?
I think, as we learn more and more, there's always room for improvement. And whether that's more base in the off season or structuring the weeks more correctly. However, I think it's gotta be more uniform to that guy, right? Like, mm-hmm. I think we gotta be a little bit more open-minded, and this guy, what works for that guy and this guy might not work for this guy. So it's kind of tying that all together. But then also just having the three of them together out here pushing each other is awesome. Mm-hmm. The vibe around the truck's awesome. We're having fun, but yet still working hard. But yeah, there's always room to teach. I mean, even as good as he is on a dirt bike, which was better than I ever was as far as technique and everything like that, mm-hmm. there's still stuff to learn and stuff to work on and break habits.
Cool. We have one more commercial break. We're back to talk about Pierce then, right? See you guys in a bit.
Adventures on hold. But now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Everyone, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGO Power Sports and Yamaha. Here with Wil Hahn, and we're going through the guys. And what about Pierce Brown? I mean, he's one of the new up and coming kids. I just got to know him, and super cool kid.
No, awesome. He's got a good head on his shoulders. He's a lot to learn. He's the young kid. I mean, most of us have been there. You get dropped in California or whatever at a young age and expected to kind of basically be an adult in a hurry. Yeah. And so, he's learning as he goes, but I think he's got so much untapped potential that we all haven't really seen yet. And I can see it during the week. I can see the determination, and like you can see it in his eyes. I mean, you can read that, and about anybody that really wants it, you can see it when they come off the track that even though they ran a good lap, it wasn't good enough. Mm-hmm. So I love seeing that. I love being around him. Like I said, he makes me kind of feel young again because he's young enough that, like, I don't know all the slangs and stuff like that. So he's teaching me as we go. And like I said, keeping me young and happy.
Yeah. Isn't that crazy? Like how old are you now?
31, but I feel like I'm like 81 when I'm hanging out with younger kids.
But like seriously, I think that because we're working in motocross, it keeps us like young personality type, right?
Yeah.
Like, so yeah, definitely, like Pierce is here, he's like this kid.
Yeah.
I'm like old guy, but still it's fun to me that I can relate to someone like that still. And like with my kids and stuff, I'm not the old dad that their other friends have, right?
Right. No, and trying to be like that, but then I'm like, a couple of times you hear someone say something, I'm like,
what does that mean?
What does it even mean?
Like, or their acronyms, right? It's like,
yeah.
What
then
is
I'm
that?
Like, I'm scared to ask him because I'm like, I don't want to think, well, Will's a nerd. I don't even know what that means, you know? Yeah. So I'm like, damn, like, I don't know. I just gotta roll with it.
Okay, so I've seen you cycling with the guys a lot and everything, and you know, through our long friendship, we've always talked about, we've ridden mountain bikes together a couple times and everything, but you've always been exceptional cross-country mountain bike racer, high-level guy, right? And so last night was the over-the-hump season opener, and you came home with a big W, Will for W.
Yeah. No, it's always something that I've loved it. And I'm lucky, like, how I was kind of brought through and how I was, I guess, my training based when I was racing. And being around Sandy and Robert Ager and Ryan Fedoro, like, they really got me kind of hooked on that, and I've always loved it. And even the last 5 years before this gig, like, I still wake up early and go on rides and just enjoy it. Kind of gives me that escape of being able to turn the brain off for at least an hour a day. And I think you get some sanity out of the overall workout, even if it's light. But no, I love it, and I'm lucky that I still have a lot of sponsors from when I was racing. Well, you know, between Specialized and Baghouse and Rock and Road, and you got Shimano and Fox and now Renthal and stuff like that. Like, it's crazy, man. Like, the overall support I still get from this, and to be a, you know, local warrior is really, really cool. And we're lucky we have races like Over the Hump that's so close in Orange County. And then you got Slasher has all his series down in San Diego. So we have this like awesome racing group with two separate, I guess, competitions, because most of the San Diego people stay down there. Most of the OC people stay down here. But between the two, like, it's awesome because I think the guys see me still digging and stuff like that, where they respect the fact that I'm still in it and I still want to be fit. And, you know, we're going to have some off-season rides here pretty soon that I can't be the one that's complaining. So I got to get ready for it.
Lead by example, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, so I saw, like, on Justin Barsha's story, he's filming you racing. Did he not race?
No.
Is he just a moral support for you?
No, he was like, hey, I'm coming out. And I'm like, no, dude, it's too hot. Like, you need to stay. We had a ride today and stuff. But he wanted to be there. I mean, he's my coach. We switched roles. He's, like, about to mix me bottles. He's got me all ready to rip. So, yeah, he's filming me, cheering me on, yelling, go faster.
Yeah.
And, no, it was really, really cool and flattering to have him out there last night, because obviously he's going to get ripped to shreds because most of the people out there are dirt bike fans. And pretty hard not to recognize JB anywhere he goes. So yeah, it was awesome.
So if JB was on the line with you, who wins?
I don't know well enough yet. I mean, the kid can, he can suffer about like anybody I've ever seen. I mean, if you watched Moto One last week, and he can dig deep. So I don't know, one of these days we'll do it.
Yeah one time at Over the Hump, I'm riding dying, right, tongue out, and I go across that bridge in the infield, and Ken Roxon's like, go, Don. Is that Roxon? So the whole half the next lap, was that Kenny?
So yeah,
it's
awesome.
Crazy who you see at these races, right?
No, and it's awesome. I love that people, I mean, the atmosphere of that overall, I mean, there's a taco truck, there's an acai bowl truck, there's beer, like, there's water, there's all this options out there, and, I mean, there's so many, like, P&G, there are all these people out there plugging their stuff, and it's honestly a good time for the family, and to see probably, I would say, 1,000 people out there last night enjoying that and enjoying bikes and being outside, I think it's great.
Yeah. Okay, so you were back with Troy Lee, you know, the Troy Lee brand. You raced for that team for many years. Have you had much of a chance to interact with Troy yet?
Or has he not been around? I think he's been gone, but I talked to him at one of the last Supercrosses and stuff like that, and obviously being around him, and, you know, he hasn't changed a bit since I've been there. I mean, it's 11 years ago now. But like I said, just the overall atmosphere is exactly how I remembered it. It's fun. And we still work hard.
Mm-hmm. Looking back on your career, you were on a show before and we touched on all that, but like, what was like the one career highlight that stands out to you?
It's a little tough. I mean, I think my, honestly, it's my first podium in Supercross, because you're bouncing between the self-doubt and this, you know, I want to achieve, but can I achieve? Like, I was always stuck between that. Like, if I just get one podium, what could it change? Or just the fact of, I mean, you know, it's crazy, because, you know, I think at the time second place was, I mean, it was basically my salary. So it was like, well, how awesome would that be? That's awesome. I could pay a credit card off. That'd be cool. And I achieved it that night. And then I it finally clicked in my brain that I can be a podium guy. Mm-hmm. And even at that point, I didn't know about maybe winning a championship. Did I want to? Of course I did. But I was like still unsure of like, can I win? But then it was like that next podium was easier. Then the next one was easier. And it was like I started trickling down. Like it was totally self-belief and basically quit self-sabotaging myself.
Yeah. It wasn't the answer I was looking for, dude.
What?
I thought you were going to say the Transworld Slam and getting that cover.
Well, no, honestly, the cover where we did the cowboy shoot was favorite one.
Yeah.
That one was awesome.
You know what's funniest about that shoot is like, we talked about doing it, and I thought, oh, there's that barn at Milestone. And I went to this Western wear place and bought boots, Wranglers. Did you have a belt with a big buckle? No, we used the Transworld belt.
Yeah.
And a dress shirt and a hat. And I turned that in on my expense report, and it got kicked back so hard. And the ladies all, what is this? Why are you buying all this Western wear? Well, it's for this lead spread of this photo shoot. And she's all, why didn't you return it after you're done? And I'm all, well, that's kind of immoral to do that, right? And she goes, Hollywood does that all the time. You know, they buy wardrobe.
I still wear it, dude.
Yeah, but I'm all, wait. You just got to see the picture, and you got to see the guy. And I sent her the picture of you that I shot, and she's all, oh, he's kind of a cute little cowboy, and she let it go.
It's always got to be cute with me, because I'm fun size. It's like a mini Snickers.
Yeah, it's like Halloween candy.
Basically.
Yeah. But you still wear some of that stuff?
Yeah, I still have the boots. The Wranglers.
Those things were tight, dude.
Yeah, I don't know if I should walk out of the house like that. Like,
they kind
of
gave you ball taco.
Yeah, it's pretty compact in that area, so I'm going to probably steer clear of that. The hat I think you took. I don't remember keeping the hat.
Really? Not, or maybe that was your hat.
Might have been. Something, I can't remember. Something with the hat, I don't remember. But yeah, the shirt, I think I ripped the sleeves off, but I still have that. Yeah. Nice pearl snap. But yeah, the boots are still get worn, I mean, pretty much any time I leave town.
Nice, that's good. Yeah, we've done a lot of fun stuff. Remember the, we went to the, what do they call the fake horse?
Oh, like, about the merry-go-round? You're talking about the bucking bull?
Yeah, we went to that Western bar to film. And
yeah,
they wouldn't let you in because you had a t-shirt with the sleeves ripped off.
Yeah, and then we had to go buy a shirt from the place.
No, they gave you a shirt.
Oh, that's right. They gave it was Rockin' Rodeo or something like that. Yeah, I remember hooking the fake horns with my shins and being like,
oh, you got taken down.
Yeah, and I'm like, I don't got it. No wonder I can't stay on a dirt bike. I couldn't stay on a horse for 5 seconds.
Yeah, that was a little gnarly. Okay, so Tom, what is Tom up to now?
He's back in Texas, working, been training some kids, doing his deal back there. And I think he just got a job opportunity, like someone in the industry, but I'm not sure. I don't want to speak too quickly on that and jinx him or whatever. But I think he'll have some exciting news here pretty soon.
Yeah. So if he comes back and he's working in the industry, is that possibly in California?
No, I don't think necessarily. I think he would.
Yeah.
For sure he would. But for this moment, I don't think necessarily, but I think you'd see him around at some more races.
I was just thinking it'd be cool to have your brother close again.
No, it would be awesome. I mean, that's the hardest part of me right now is like, you know, just not see my family as much as I'd like to.
Yeah, right on. Well, hey, we're out of time. Thanks for coming on again, bud.
Thank you, guys.
I'll see you in a few weeks at your wedding. Is it going to be one of those like Hawaiian shirt weddings?
No.
Okay, so we dress normal?
Yeah, I'd say, well, whatever you want to wear, dude. No one's going to get kicked out. Well, someone might get kicked out, but we'll see.
Yeah. Anyway, thanks for coming on. Congratulations on the new gig. Congrats on the new relationship. Good luck with that. And, we'll see you guys next time. Thanks for tuning in. Be sure to like and subscribe. And check out swapmotolive.com.